Hello everyone, I'm Sha, the writing and research half of the Tales and Oracle of 11. Some of you may know me as Little Cat on this channel, but for those who are new, hello, 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 and I hope you're having a great week, month, year, and beyond. I can say that most people on this planet have some interest in the supernatural. Even people who proclaim themselves a true skeptic will feel a niggling of doubt in the back of their minds when strange things go bump in the night. The chat goes from musings about the artistic process and makes a sharp turn into ghost stories, curses, and creepy happenings, and then calms down a little while talking about the origins of the Nangkwak and each component that makes up a spirit house and its offerings. Here I sit, conversing with Pavii, our artist from Thailand. I'm going to say thank you for joining me for this chat. I'm very, very interested in talking about your art. Nangkwak?
Yes, Nangkwak, yes.
It's so cute. She is so cute. She's just a different body shape that I want to talk about in this representation of. But first, the introduction. How would you like to be introduced? What do we call you? And where can we find you on the internet?
Hi, I'm Pavii. I'm a Thai freelance illustrator based in Germany. I have a special love for collage and nature, animals, and children are constant inspirations that find a way into my art. And my Instagram is pavini.illustration. It's pavinee.illustration. It's where I showcase my artwork, show my creative process, and provide glimpses into the stories behind each piece.
How did you find yourself in the arts? Like, how did you begin drawing as a child?
As an artist, I think I discovered my passion for the arts through a personal journey of self-discovery and exploration. I think it started from a young age where I found joy in the artistic activities such as drawing, painting, and creating, like, you know, the paper mache in a school, mm-hmm. the art class in school. I really like that. Mm-hmm. And over time, I honed my skills and experimenting with different artistic mediums and techniques. And my beloved is collage, of course, is the traditional digital. And through this process, I gained a deeper understanding of my artistic voice and voice style is developed over time. Uh-huh. And I think I began working mostly in the kid lit field after holding a master's degree in children's book illustration from Cambridge School of Art a couple of years ago. But even though I work most in a children's book area, I still enjoy illustrating book covers and designing packaging and music album covers or any interesting projects like this one.
Oh, okay. You spoke about designing album covers. What was the most interesting one?
The one I really liked, it was for a trans indie artist from from the US. She contacted me and via Instagram, and she was very, very nice. And she told me this concept of it's like something that lived in my head. Huh? It's about a creature, the little creatures that live in the woods, and that's the things I draw. And that's the concept of her albums. It's an album that expresses how she feels, like she's a different creature than the other ones in the woods, like in the world, because of how hard it is being trans to her.
Uh-huh.
And she wanted me to express that, but in a loving and warm tone illustrations, because even though it's hard, she wanted this album to be comforting piece of art.
Yeah, because I can sort of imagine that album covers in general is really hard because some of them can get really abstract. To me, I would find it really hard for somebody to come up and say, draw something that is so meaningful to the other person. I would be so stuck. I'll be like, oh my God. Oh, this is so hard.
I think it helps when the client has clear image in their head. It always helps in it. I think when it's hard to work when the client doesn't know what they really want. But with this band, they were amazing. They gave me freedom, but at the same time they have their vision, their clear image, what they need, but they let me do it at my liberty, at my artistic choice. So it was a fantastic project and a fantastic experience for me.
That's amazing. Can you tell me a little bit about your avatar? It's a cute girl. Is that you? Is it supposed to be you?
It's me, but I did it around 4 years ago when I had very short hair and I didn't cut my hair from then. So now my hair is so long and I don't really look similar to that at all. It's an avatar that I did for a magazine. It was a popular magazine in Thailand called A Day. It was like an art magazine, but it just closed down this year. Yeah, unfortunately. I did for them a collage piece of, it was a column of collection of something I collected, and I collect picture books. So I did the collage piece of that, and I think, oh, it would be fun to make a pro avatar pic of me in collage also. So that's why this happened. Just
That
happened in a whim,
explains.
actually.
That explains all the textures and how it looks cut and pasted.
Because this is the traditional collage, yes.
Oh, fantastic. That's awesome. Oh my God. I love it even more now.
Oh, thank you. Yes, it's been so long that I've done the traditional collage now since I got my iPad. It's such a convenient tool, isn't it?
Yes, I'm a fan of technology. If it can make my life easier, and I can automate things, I'm 100% on board.
And now I've learned to manipulate my digital art into looking more like the traditional one, so now I'm enjoying it more.
Oh, are you a very hands-on person? Because you spoke about paper mache when you were a kid in school, and then you did this collage. Were you more hands-on with your art than pen and paper?
Yes, I think so, especially after my master's. I mean, during that time I had a very dark time because I had a burned out and art block for a very long time that I couldn't hold on a pencil, and whenever I see an empty piece of paper, I panicked because I felt pressure that I have to make something good, and I felt like I couldn't do that. So during that time, I didn't draw for months.
Oh, that's a
But one,
struggle.
it was very hard. But one day I was looking through like cooking magazines, and then I found these tiny cute cupcakes, and I just cut them out of magazine with scissors. Just the cut out the photograph of the cupcakes, and then I started cutting, and then I try to make them into the photo collage. Just put it here, and if I'm not satisfied with this here, just move it. And that was quite that was very therapeutic to me because I didn't have the burden of creating something from the scratch. I have these cut out photographs of cute cupcakes and dogs, cats, and then I can put them anywhere on the paper. And yeah, that's why I started my collage journey actually. And after that, when I had to create my own project, I created my own paste paper. The paste paper that, I mean, I made it with the acrylic colors in a white paper. I used dry brush, and acrylic colors, and I just dip the brush into the color and then just pen some random strokes on the paper, and it creates, you know, messy or random strokes. And then I cut them out into leaves or other shapes, and then that's how I make my traditional collage from there.
I'm learning a lot. I don't think I've heard the term paste paper before.
Yeah, I've never learned that before. When I started making it, I didn't know what I did, but I like what I did, so I was searching on like what was I doing.
Like,
and
it,
yeah,
doesn't it make you feel like every time you do something and you think you're okay, like you came up with this 100%, let's just say. There's something at the back of your mind saying, there's no way somebody else didn't already make this.
Yeah, I know what you mean, yes. But it was also reassuring to know that, oh, so a lot more people know this. So there are a lot more art to explore with this style. And I read, and then I found many more techniques to make mark makings on the paper to create more interesting textures.
Mm-hmm. It's
yeah,
it's
so
like
it was
super
fun.
Scrapbooking.
Yeah, but now you don't cut them out from the magazines anymore. You just make everything by yourself.
I think that's way better. When you were talking about arranging things on a page and you didn't have to make it, the fact that you have to make the decisions of where to put stuff, I feel like 'cause I come from interior design. And part of it is space planning, right? So I feel like doing it on a page is a lot like designing a space. But it's low stakes, and it is very way more therapeutic than moving chairs and desks and couches and carpets and lighting. Oh my God, lighting. I hate lighting.
Oh.
I mean, I love lighting. I just don't like to think about it.
Yeah, I know. It was makes or break, right? But that's the thing. It can be very good or very not good.
And the fact that you can do all this amazing collage just shows how good you are at perception of depth and knowing where everything needs to sit. And also there's a form of like a release of control, I think, because once you put it there, you're like, meh, you live there now.
Oh. Yeah, it's hard for me. It's what I struggle the most. The thing about composition and colors, especially. I think I still have a lot to learn. But after I use the digital media, I think I've improved a lot, because I struggle a lot with it at first. But with the digital media, and then I can undo it, you know. So it's just tap, oh no, again, and then. And there are different layers that you can do, and
Have you ever done this in real life? You're using, for example, whatever it is, Corel Draw or Photoshop, and you control Z because you have made a mistake. And then you go out in real life and you write on a real book, and then you watch yourself reach out to nothing and click control Z.
I know.
And then you stone
it.
As your friends look at you like, what the hell is wrong with you?
Yeah, I'm guilty of that all the time. And sometimes when I did something wrong, I wish I could undo that. I think that every day. Oh, why? I wish I could undo that action.
You live in Germany now, and before that, you were in the UK. How much do you know about your country's folktales and oral history? Like, how entrenched for you in storytelling?
I think growing up, I didn't have much exposure to the local tales, as they often involve spirits and ghosts. So the adults in my family wanted to shield us kids from anything that might scare us. they didn't want us to be afraid to go to the toilet at night and wake them up or something like that. So... yeah, but however, I started explore these stories later in life, both through my own research. I had a time that I was obsessed with UFO, or the time that I was obsessed with supernatural things when I was young, you know. And also
I agree
through
with that,
studying
yes.
it in school, yeah, because there are a lot of Thai literatures about this stuff. And I have a fond memory in my school time that during the time, I think about almost the last year of school, I had a particular interest in the ghost stuff, as well as some friends of mine. So every few days, also we would have a club meeting where we tell each other stories of ghosts or supernatural events or urban legends. Yeah, and I think it's through this kind of personal exploration and education that we often discover the hidden gems of our tradition and stories.
You had a ghost club.
Yeah, kind of. And we had this friend who loves reading. So every day she read one ghost novel, and then she tells it to us every day after lunch.
That's so cute.
It was that the live podcast live that
it's
we
horror
that
stories.
We yeah.
Do you still listen to a lot of like horror themed podcasts and stories now?
Yeah, absolutely, all the time. I only listen to audio dramas, horror audio dramas.
Oh, which ones?
Oh, there are a lot. Actually, now I'm listening to Unwell. Do you know? It's a Unwell is a gothic, a Midwestern gothic mystery. And it's
no.
in the last season. It's almost done. My favorite one, absolute favorite, my number one is The White Vault.
I have not heard of any of these. You had a ghost storytelling club in your school. Were you in high school at that time, or?
Yeah, in high school.
And then that habit brought you all the way to adulthood, where you're like, you don't listen to murder mysteries, you listen to ghost stories. You know how some people, they're like, oh yeah, true crime is where I live. No, I'm like, ghosts is where I live. I'm from Southeast Asia.
Yeah.
That is my
exactly.
life.
Yeah, I live for cosmic horror.
Oh, yes. Oh, tasty. Everybody's like, but it's scary because it's existential and you don't know anything. And I'm like, it's scary because you don't know anything. That's
the
place to be, man. And the funny thing is, you were saying that your parents tried to shield you and your siblings away from scary stuff. My mom used to tell me to come back home and stop playing outside before it becomes 6:30, because that's when the ghost will come out and grab you and hide you away. When I was a child, like that's where we live in. It's like, if you don't come back home, ghosts will steal you and I will never find you again. Do you want that? And I'm like, no, I want dinner. Okay.
Yeah, I've heard something like that too, but I think in my family we did it a lot, a bit more extreme. Like they wouldn't threaten me with a ghost, but they would threaten me with the real people. Like a kidnapper will come get you if you don't come back. And that was traumatizing in a way. But so I learned to be careful.
I think at that time there weren't a lot of kidnappings, and if there were,
yeah,
it wasn't real. It was just parents being parents and kind of racist in that era. So I don't want to think about that. Because it's like, wow, we really said that. As adults, you really said that out loud. Damn, you would be so cancelled right now.
I know. Oh, one story. Let's just remember. I think my family didn't want to talk about ghosts because most of them are afraid of ghosts, actually. I mean, like typical Thai people. Most Thais are afraid of ghosts.
That is fair.
Yeah, and most of them believe in ghosts.
Mm-hmm.
Yeah, I can't say that I actually believe in them, but I don't say that I don't believe in them.
Yeah, I'm with you on that. I sit on the fence. I have had some very strange experiences growing up when it comes to spirits and things you cannot see. Like, I'll be going up the stairs, and then from the corner of my eye, I will see shadows. Or one day when I'm at home, somebody's playing with the doorbell. When I open the door, there's nobody there. Or I'll feel very uneasy. And then the unease goes away when at the corner of my eye, I see a little cat tail. But at the same time, the other side of my brain is going, that doesn't exist. That makes no sense. There's no such thing. Go to sleep.
Yeah, I know. I know it's the same for me. But my family told me that when I was very young, like four, 4 or 5 years old. One day I was walking upstairs, and then I just came running down crying,
Oi.
and I asked, why is there a woman with the long hair and red lips and white face in the bathroom? Who is she?
Oh,
And
that's creepy.
I know. Oh, what time is it in what time is it there?
It
That's so
is.
cool.
It's 10:47. Don't worry about me. I have my cats protecting me. They're
Okay.
fine. They will
Yes.
protect me from ghosties.
Yeah, and that was the thing that I remember that they told when I was old enough, I mean in my teenage year, that why did I say that?
Oh.
I don't know why did I say that? I don't know, did I actually see it, or did I see something in the newspapers or in the TV, and then I just hallucinated it and imagined it? I don't know. Yeah, but that thing creeped my family too.
I would be creeped out as well, 'cause my sister did the same thing. So we were playing with candles in our room. I think we were, I think n nine. I was nine, I think. Like, we were very young, and we were playing with candles 'cause they were very cute. They were candles shaped like ducks. So we just burned them, and the top of the duck's head is where the candle wick is. It's such a weird place to put. Like, you're just melting a duck head first. It's kind of macabre in a way. Like, why did you design this like this? You're beheading a duck. Why? Anyway, so we played with the fire. I was using the candle wax to make tiny little Barbie doll plates. Don't ask me. I was a weird kid. When my sister picked up a candle and went to the cupboard, we broke one of the doors. So one side of the cupboard was closed. Mind you, the whole room is dark, with only the light of candlelight. She held it up, and then she gasped, and the she dropped the candle. It snuffed out, thankfully, otherwise everything would be burning. And then she ran to me, and then I got up and turned on the light and went, "What happened?" And she said she saw a black figure putting its hand up in an attempt to choke her.
Oh
And I was
no,
like, why would you say that? I'm 9 years old. I'm sleeping next to the cupboard.
oh, that's scary.
So we slept with the lights on.
Yeah, as you should.
And we never played with candles again.
Oh,
But
yes,
you
maybe.
see, like, I went through so many things as a child that's kind of creepy. And my sister had a lot of, like, you know, when you, what is it, sleep paralysis demons. Like, she had a few instances where she had sleep paralysis. And as an adult, I'm like, yeah, that didn't really happen. That's just your mind playing tricks on you. That's just you not really waking up. Like, I can rationalize my way out of it, I think, but there's still a part of me that says, these things are real.
That I think there are a lot of things that can't be explained, really.
Yeah, so I
For
like super fence on the fence about it, the eternally. People are like, do you believe in ghosts? I'm like, I don't know. Like, maybe.
yeah, for example, I think I don't want to believe it, but I kind of believe in like hexing or voodoo. I'm not sure in Thai. I don't know the name in
Like, cursing
Thai.
people.
I think that is true because I've experienced it firsthand. I mean, from the people from my family. I didn't want to believe it, but there is actually no other explanation for that.
Do you want to talk about it? This is so interesting.
I mean, like some people did some stuff to my house, and then and my mother, she kind of believes in this stuff. So one day she went to a bush. She said that there might be something there, and she dug under the bush, and there is like a doll and a broken ceramic
Oh, you got
buried
hexed.
beside the house. And at that time, my house was very unstable. I mean, in my family, and without reason why. One time, there was some crazy people in the house that tried to hex my brother for some reason, and that was very scary because my mother found under his pillow like a bunch of hair,
Oh.
long hair and also like a drop of kind of dark brown itch that look like blood and another thing. I don't know. And during that time, my brother, he had very bad dreams and like 3 4 days in a row, and it was a dream that he woke up in his own bed and in the house. So he was walking around the house looking for people, and then he found his friends, all of his friends, 10 friends, lying face down dead in the living room in our house. And there was this very old woman, old wrinkled woman, who laughed at him, who followed him around in his dreams. And he had the same dream over and over again. And there was no explanation at all, because my brother, he doesn't watch any scary movies. He's not particularly afraid of ghosts. He just doesn't care about it that much. So he has no interest in this. And suddenly he just has this dream. Yeah,
And
it was.
hair and blood under the pillow. How did these people go into your house?
No, it's actually like a member of my family, but they are crazy. I don't. Yeah.
Oh. Yeah, I've heard of
Yeah.
that. We have stories here where members of the family who are jealous of you will hex you.
Just so crazy all around.
Well,
Like, why
I
would you
hope your
do
family's okay now.
Yeah, absolutely. They are completely okay. That was a very long time ago.
Can you tell me what attracted you to your story, to this story, and what is the story?
Nangkwak is the spirit of luck and wealth. You will usually see stars with her in them because she's kind of similar to a Japanese lucky cat. The bird of its paw to get customers and also to get the luck to come their way. I know that it's kind of a myth that she's the first Thai woman to be skilled in weaving.
Ah.
So it was able to become a like a sellable product. The guak is the hand. And so that's the thing that the new thing that attracts customers, attracts their interest and then their money.
As she rose into her status as like a mini god by becoming the
Yeah.
first entrepreneur and selling her
Yeah.
silks and just being really,
Yeah.
really good at it.
Yes.
That's awesome. Like, straight up, in a good way. I say this in a good way, okay? She's straight up girl bossing. And now she's just in shops instead of cats. Either or, they're both awesome. Can you tell me how you directed your piece? Because I see components that I don't understand because this isn't my culture.
Yes, so the official name of this piece is Nangkwak in the Spirit House, as you can see at the in the background. She and it looks like she sits in a temple, but that's actually a spirit house. A spirit house in Thailand is a shrine to protect the spirit of a place. Like every place has spirits living in it. So, for example, if you move to a new plot to build a house or something, you have to build a spirit house to pay your respect to the spirits that live in that land. And the votive offerings are left at the house to propitiate the spirits. And the spirits, a spirit house may contain various images and statues, and Nangkwak is one of the common one. You can have many angels in a spirit house, like angels to protect you from, I don't know, bad weather or from bad luck, and Nangkwak is to get you wealth. The Nangkwak in my illustration, she's wearing a traditional Thai costume and with a bag of money in hand to symbolize wealth. And she has floral garlands offerings around her neck and hand, as often seen in the spirit's house, because of floral garland offerings is the traditional Thai common traditional Thai offerings for the religious rituals. And the spirit house is adorned with the typical Thai offerings such as lotus and incense and candles, common Thai fruits such as mandarin, mangosteen, coconut, pomegranate, banana, and most importantly, the red soda.
Why red soda?
Mostly it's Fanta. Yes. I did the research why they use red soda for offering and found that because Thais associate the color red with blood.
Ah.
So signifying both fertility and sacrifice. So when you offer something, you just sacrifice something for the gods, you know? And without using the real blood, red soda becomes popular and seems like the best option.
I feel like, yes. Can you imagine being a god and having hundreds of years where people just kill animals and spill blood in your name, and then one day they're just like, you know what, we're just gonna use Fanta. And you're expecting, because blood is very slippery, right? And thick.
Yeah.
And you're sitting there expecting blood. You're like, oh, here it goes. It's blood time. And then instead, in your cup flows this beautiful, fizzy, sweet smelling drink, and you're like, this isn't blood.
This is better than blood.
This is better. This is tasty. It's made of sugar.
Red soda is my favorite, but it's not that easy to find. You can't really find red soda in a convenience stores, actually. You have to go to the store for offerings.
Really?
To buy red sodas.
Wait, so you can't use any red soda. It has to be like a specific one.
No, we can use any red soda, but normally you wouldn't typically find the red soda selling 7-Eleven or other convenience stores, because normally you would take like orange soda or other flavor, but not the red one. I don't know why. It's just not that popular thing
people. I have to say though, when it comes to drinking soda, I'm definitely an orange fan. Like, I will go for the orange soda.
Me too. In Thailand, there is a culture that, I mean, we believe in superstitions, a lot of superstition.
Mm-hmm.
And many people, before they get a car, they would go to a temple. Or to what's the name? To someone who can look at your fate. I don't know what's the name.
Like a fortune teller.
Yeah, a fortune teller. To ask them which car would bring them luck in money, luck in love, or luck in work.
Mm-hmm.
Something like that. And if they say, oh, you should get green car for the luck in work, but you don't like green car, or for some reason you can't get a green car, so you just get a car of other color, and then you buy a sticker written, this car is green.
No! Are you serious?
Yes, and that's the thing that I've seen that thing all my life, and I always thought, oh, that's normal, isn't it? And then I just realized, no, it's not normal. Why? Who are you telling? That red car is green. Who are you telling that to?
That is so funny. Like,
yeah, it is funny.
You're supposed to be a god, and you're like, but say you're the one bequeathing the luck, right? And you're the one giving luck for work, and then the person is supposed to have a green car.
You only give it to people with green cars.
Yeah, and then you see the car, and it's clearly not green; it's yellow. But there's a sticker that says this car is green. You're like, yeah, that checks out.
Yeah, I never thought of that as weird, but then okay, that's weird. Thailand is full of absurdities.
It's so funny. It's also really cute, in that, like, it makes me just want to go to places and put stickers that says, instead of orange soda, it's grape. Like, this is grape soda. Then people be like, yeah, okay, then checks out.
Yes. And that is not only a few people who use, a lot of people use that.
Do you just buy these stickers wherever? Like, do they just sell it?
Yeah, whatever.
Why did nobody tell me this? I've been to Thailand so many times. I could have bought a sticker that says this car is green or blue, whatever.
Maybe it's too common that people hadn't thought about it.
Because I don't read Thai script, so I can't read it. But why didn't anybody tell me? If my friends are listening to this, I'm judging you. I'm judging you so hard right now. I could be the proud owner of a sticker on my phone that says this phone is red. No, this phone is a Samsung, but it's clearly not. This is just lying to you. Like, straight
It
up gaslighting.
is. Yeah, gaslighting gods.
Oh God. Is God colorblind? Is that it? Like they just use words. Like I'm gonna assume that it's real.
Or maybe they're just very forgiving, so they just grant you wishes at bare minimum. Oh, there is an effort there, and we can see it. So okay, here's the luck.
They just have really good lawyers. I mean, the people have really good lawyers. It says
Yeah,
it's green on the label.
they can be very creative regarding the superstition stuff.
I think that's very it's a very human thing to do, to come up with solutions, very creative solutions to problems that you technically wouldn't have if not for superstition. Half the time, as I'm living as a Malaysian, I'm wondering, who did we steal this from and why?
It's like a mixing pot, isn't it?
And I'm sure it's like that in Thailand as well, because of the Silk Road, there's a lot of, I think, Chinese travelers who end up living in Thailand and then gets naturalized into Thais.
Exactly, and there are a lot of the people, local people, like Mon people, who are not entirely Thai, but they just everything just mixed. I think during one point of the time there was law that forced everyone to be Thai, to have Thai name, to learn Thai, and to not speak other languages. And that's just very sad, because a lot of cultures, a lot of traditions just went away because of that.
I actually had a bit of trouble trying to find mythological stories from Thailand, especially like pre-Buddhism, like something that has nothing to do with Buddhism or China or India or Hinduism. It was so hard for me to find like indigenous stories. And I don't know if you want to talk about this. We can probably cut it out. It's mostly out of pure curiosity at this point. I couldn't find a lot of indigenous people's groups in Thailand, like not a lot of documentation.
Yeah, I don't really have knowledge in this area. But I think in the central, there was a big group of Mon people. But later, they just kind of got dissolved into Thai because they had quite similar cultures and stuff. And, somehow they're just gone. But in the north, I know that there are a lot of indigenous people in the north. But the thing is, with indigenous people in the north, most, not most, but a lot of them are not accepted in being Thai. I mean, they are not, how to call it, legalized.
Oh, but
Even though they were born here, everything that they're Thai and they speak Thai, but they are not legalized for some reason, for some political reason.
In other words, they are, I hazard to say, treated like immigrants in their own country. That's so strange. I mean, I know Malaysians are really bad with our indigenous people as well. We're trying to get better. We are trying really hard. But at the same time, we as multiple peoples have not been kind to indigenous folks in general. Like, it doesn't matter which country you're from. You can be from Malaysia, Thailand, you can be from Australia. America is another one. Like, we're just not nice to indigenous people.
Yes, in Thailand, it's just that there is a lot of problem in the north. I mean, they live in poverty, they don't have access to education or to good water or electricity. It's just big, all because of the political problems.
Do you think it's
And
going to
also
get
because
better?
I'm not sure. The thing is, Thailand, all of the developments, all of the technologies and all the new things, all of the opportunities are in Bangkok and not many in other places. Maybe in other places, just other big cities like Khon Kaen or Chiang Mai or Phuket, and that's all.
So it's extremely, extremely biased when it comes to modernization.
Yeah,
Oh, that's unfortunate.
extremely.
I
Yeah,
guess it's just
so.
like that everywhere. Like, as much as I want to say my country bad and our government is shit, I guess it's just like that everywhere.
Yes, but yeah, I think every country has their own problems, but some countries has more problems. For example, in comparison with Germany and Thailand, at least here they have democracy, and we don't really have that in Thailand. That's the basic things.
Thank you so much for sitting down with me and talking with me and spending time.
Thanks to you too for being so kind and making me comfortable. And for this interview, it was very entertaining for me. I haven't talked to people for quite some time, so this is very nice.
Thank you everybody for watching. If you're listening to this while the campaign is going on, please go to Kickstarter, back us up. It's going to be good for everyone. Thank you to my friend here, Pavii, for speaking with me for a really long time. Most of it, you guys will not be able to listen to because I have to cut this down to 40 minutes, but I enjoyed myself. I hope Pavii enjoyed herself too. And we would
Yes,
like
agreed.
and we would like you to be good, be safe. COVID is still around. Mask up and enjoy yourself. Bye.